Thanks very much, Gary. I have to tell you, I'm so excited about this topic. Quick show of hands, how many of you are a consumer? See, everyone can relate to what we're going to talk about this morning. It's great. We're going to be talking about the changing global consumer landscape and how it's shaping the future of consumption. Now, it's fascinating to consider the busiest shopping mall in North America is Toronto's Eaton Centre, attracting 57.3 million visitors per year. According to my stats, that's more than Walt Disney World and Times Square. Pretty incredible. In 24 hours, on November 11th, 2018, $31 billion of sale took place on Alibaba's e-commerce platform in China. And in 48 hours, Black Friday, Cyber Monday, Amazon recorded $14 billion of e-commerce sales in the US. So by all accounts, the global outlook for consumption is bullish, and so says my husband. The North American consumer has never been healthier, and the world's largest and fastest growing middle class consumer markets are in populous China, India, Indonesia, and Africa. The reality, however, is disruption, serious disruption for retailers and brands due to overinvestment in bricks and mortar stores in markets like the US that have led to many iconic brands to fail. Rising anti-competition challenges over the dominant control of advertising and consumers by large digital platforms like Facebook, Google, and Amazon. Changing consumers, as we well know here in Toronto, urban millennials living in tiny city condos, preferring bikes over cars and sensitive to their impact on the planet. And the impact of tidying up with Marie Kondo, whose Netflix sensation sparks joy as you tidy up, declutter, and temper your consumer instincts. This show has had a tremendous cultural impact in the US, the UK, and my husband's closet. So these strategic questions that these raise for our expert panelists today, are my consumers price-driven or experience-driven? And what form does this take in different markets? And about my consumers, how do I find them and how do they find me? We're joined by four global business leaders who are intimately acquainted with the effects of this changing consumer landscape and its impacts it's having on their industries. Wendy Clark leads DDB Worldwide, recognized as the world's largest and most influential ad and marketing network. DDB perennially ranks as the agency of the year on numerous global ranking scales, and as a global advertising agency, has over 200 offices in 95 countries. She's just back from India, which is why she's warm with no sleeves on this morning. I read with interest her interviews there as she's reflecting on the opportunity that market has. At a time when technological and social disruptions are transforming the way traditional forms of advertising have and can work, Wendy's work at DDB is leading the way to help brands evolve more creatively. And she's often quoted, as I look at many of your news releases, she's often quoted as saying, creativity is the most powerful voice in business. So thanks so much for joining us here in Toronto today. In its day-to-day operations, DDB interacts with a great number of global brands, advises them on their communication and advertising strategies. So from your perspective, what are consumers looking for when they decide which brands they will choose?
Well, thank you for the opportunity to be here. You know, consumers do vary around the world, so I think we always have to be careful when we take sort of large swaths of, make statements for large swaths of people. But in general, I think the shift is what we're focusing on. And if you think about the fact that every minute of the day, there's 18 million emails that are sent, there's about 5 million Google searches, there's about 4.5 million YouTube videos viewed, 300,000 Instagram stories are posted, and indeed 1.4 million Tinder swipes. And you think about the fact that all those platforms are less than 20 years old, that really points to the change that brands certainly and companies have had to lean into, right? How do you engage a consumer and what is that consumer looking for in that moment. What they're looking for is authenticity, transparency. They're looking for values from those brands and companies. What they're not looking for is a veneer, the wrapping paper that a brand used to be able to put into the world and, you know, sort of a one-way push environment where they could push out their message into the world and it would, you know, be, we can think about recall some of the wonderful branding and advertising of the 70s and 80s. That's gone now. What consumers want is real, raw, open, transparent, two-way communication with a brand and a company. They want to know who they're doing business with. To your opening statement, yes, they want a value. They're always going to seek a value, but they want to understand that there's much more than sort of a branded veneer at that company, and that's a company that stands for something that has done enduringly so and has evidence and actions that they can point to that say, yeah, this is a brand and a company that cares about me, cares about my community, cares about society more broadly, and is willing to be a company that I can look into and see what kind of company I'm transacting with. So those are just a few thoughts.
No, and that's a brilliant segue to Jim. Jim Dinkins is joining us. He's president of Coca-Cola North America, obviously a senior leader in one of the world's largest, if not the largest, beverage company. Now, speaking of branding in the 70s, some of us may recall that I'd like to buy the World of Coke campaign. It was breathtaking, it was amazing. The world responded. You're all over the world today. Now, what I'd like to understand, I mean, you're responding to changing consumer demands from a single product, which used to be Coke, to over 500 brands now in more than 200 countries. So what are the main traits of today's consumers, and what are you focusing on as you're adapting Coca-Cola to that market?
Well, Jan, also thank you for having me. It's great to be here in the panel, and thank you for having me today with you. You know, we're a 133-year-old company as of May of this year. And one of the hallmarks of the people who came before me is really staying close to consumers to figure out what they want and how to evolve. And at that time, that's what consumers want. And I agree with Wendy that it's you can't paint a broad brush, but in North America, we're really seeing that consumers want a couple of things. One, they want a lot of choice. You know, as you talked about, that advertising campaign was probably about one brand that we had, and that's all we had in that time in the 70s, maybe a couple. But they want choice, they want personalization, they want customization. They've redefined convenience. Convenience is used to be top 5 or 10 minutes from my home, and now it's now. Yeah. That's convenience. And the other thing that I agree with Wendy about is they want to do business with people who do business the right way. And so, as you mentioned, we've pivoted from that time in the 70s to have one product or maybe two products and a couple of packages to a vision we call Beverages for Life, which really means we want to provide the products that people want everywhere, anywhere during that time of day. So we've had to pivot as well. And we actually have 4,100 products across the world now. Everything from milks, dairy, to juices, to waters, to our carbonated soft drinks. So the key is going to be, I think Prime Minister Trudeau was credited with saying, things have never moved this fast and they'll never move this slow again. And I think that's true. And so we've got to continue to adapt to make sure we are relevant to modern consumers.
No, that's great. And a very warm welcome to Nicola Farinetti, who leads Italy North America, a company with a very innovative business model that brings food knowledge and culture under one roof. From its first location in Torino, Italy in 2007, Italy, which is a play on Eat Italian, has expanded to 35 locations around the world. My son is so excited. They're set to open up its their first Canadian location, 50,000 square feet of marketplace in the Manulife Center in Bloor Street in Toronto. He'll be at the front of the line to get in the door, Nicola. It's a pleasure to have you here. Eataly is as much a food retailer as it is an experience space. So what's your perspective on today's consumer? How are companies such as Eataly responding to consumer needs and importance? And finally, what's the importance of experience?
Thank you, grazie. Eataly is a very simple idea. Food is the only thing we put inside of our body. Therefore, it's the most important. Mm-hmm. So our message is teach consumers on the importance of quality food. To do that, we didn't do a restaurant, we didn't do a market, we did not do a school. We created a unique experience blending these three messages together. I think it's important to realize, as we said, most of these new companies are only 20 years old. We are 12 years old. We are very young. So we're not trying to adapt to fit this market. We were born into this market. We were among the first true experiential retail company. And I believe today we basically fight against people time. Everyone is busier every day. You just flow from India to do this. Things are getting more connected. I can get whatever I want, wherever I want. So I basically have to convince everybody every day that it's worth their time to get into my store. And in order to do that, we do big places with a lot of counter, a lot of interaction, a lot of moment, a lot of storytelling, a lot of products, a lot of events. And we believe that that is compelling for our customers. They are not coming to shop. They are not coming to learn. They're not coming to eat. They're coming to spend their time and eventually find something that they believe is worth what they're looking for. I usually compare Italy and experiential retail to theater. You can build a theater. You want to do it beautiful. You want to put the right chairs. The hallway needs to be as big as it needs to be. The speakers need to be amazing. Everything needs to be right. But at the end of the day, if you don't have a show to put on the stage, you don't sell the ticket. So experiential retail is building the theater, but then remind yourself that you need to put a show on every single day of the week. And if you do that, I believe today you meet customers' experience.
That's great. Now, in my opening remarks, I was reflecting on a changing consumer that's concerned about the planet. And so, Frank, we've got Frank Burrell is here. He's Executive Vice President with ENGIE. This is a global energy and services group operating in power, gas, and energy services. Very interesting organization. They're working to deliver an energy transition to a low-carbon economy. They've developed solutions for personal customers, urban authorities, and companies. They apply their expertise in natural renewable gas, renewable electrical, energy efficiency, and digital technology to help people, cities, and companies operate in a low-carbon environment. So thanks for joining us today, Frank. The energy sector is receiving a great deal of attention from consumers, from citizens, regarding challenges of climate change. So talk to us about how you're positioned, how energy is positioned to respond to this. How do you balance response to consumers while also providing results for shareholders?
Well, ENGIE is the largest independent power and energy services provider in the world. Our 160,000 employees have the ambition of leading our customers into the zero carbon transition. We do that most around the world, mostly for businesses, cities, universities, schools, hospitals, more than for consumers. But what is important is that 4 years ago, we decided to go from a traditional utility business into a drastically changed company leading this zero carbon transition. And by drastically, I mean 15 billion asset rotation in less than 3 years and a massive internal transformation because our teams needed to follow and adopt and lead that change. Today, we're so 2 years ago, or last year, we announced that we had fulfilled all our goals and we needed to go to the next stage. The next stage is really leading the zero carbon transition for our customers. So we continue to develop and produce more renewables, renewable energy, but we also recognize that energy efficiency is at the core of the zero carbon transition. Energy efficiency doesn't mean only saving energy, but using better energy, consuming better, greener, safer, better timing, locally sourced. So all these needs to be developed. And so we offer to our customers the largest in-house array of technical for that. And we want to help them approach this in a global way, because there is no silver bullet. If you really want to transition towards the zero carbon, you need to use the whole technical, all the technologies that are available. To the consumer behavior, it's interesting that many years back, sustainability was a subject of philanthropy. Then it became a subject of savings. You know, energy was expensive. People try to do it for savings. Today, it's at the core of every business. Not only because the consumer like it or demand it, and it's a driver for choice, but also in the talent war. And so for the first part and the consumer, I just have to look at my five kids, and it's amazing how they shop and where they go and where the decision making is. And in the talent war, I travel the world, and there is not one single place where talents, candidates, don't start the conversation with, what are you doing about the climate change? What is your commitment? What are you doing to reduce your carbon footprint? So we believe we are in the center of this change because it's driving not only consumers but citizens.
No, it's quite interesting because we're actually in the midst of a project right now with one of our airports and some of our innovators. And what they're looking to do is create a kind of Fitbit for their passengers so that the morning they wake up in their condo the day of a trip, they can have some choices on how they get to the airport, how they navigate through the airport, how they go along their journey to reduce carbon impact. So choices of how you get there, what do you do about luggage, that type of thing. So it's not just a nice to do, it's not just an idealistic thing. It's gonna be very, very core to, I think, where businesses and services are gonna be going.
And educating the consumer about what is available and how to better use it is really essential. Mm-hmm. So for our customers, but for their own consumers, we deliver saver services, but data, availability to data, and how to make it understandable and usable for the end consumer.
Okay. So this has been great to set the stage. I want to open up some questions for all of you on similar categories. Very interested in this phenomena of this growing middle class. And so what business strategies are you employing to try to capture some of this growing middle class? And let's talk about it with examples against different markets, because we're very familiar with the North American middle class, but how is your approach differing with some of these new fast-growing middle class markets globally? Wendy, let's start with you.
So I think obviously the growing middle class is deeply interesting to many of the brands and the companies that we work with. What you heard Jim mention in his comments earlier is really important, which is customization and personalization. And consumer increasingly has an expectation that no matter the size of company or brand, that they are known on a one-to-one level. In fact, if we just sort of take our professional hats off in a minute and act as consumers, to your opening question, aren't we deeply frustrated when a brand targets us in a way that it is not, you know, relevant to us? I use an example often when I shop for a baby shower gift for a friend of mine, and then that baby, all of a sudden I was having a baby at 48 years old, you know, and the fact that the search engine couldn't be smart enough to know that that wasn't for me, that was for someone else. When companies and brands look ham-fisted, we get very, very frustrated now as consumers. So ways that we're expanding and engaging with that expanding income that we're seeing around the world is through customization and personalization. That requires deep data knowledge and understanding. It requires technical understanding and real-time engagement that you can understand the data, target that customer in a way that's relevant to them in the moment, and create an engagement and then hopefully a relationship over time that you can build out. But that is absolutely the expectation of that consumer, is that if you're gonna use my data, and of course there's a whole discussion we can have on data use, but if you're gonna use my data, use it well. Don't use it poorly, because then there's no utility, no benefit for me. But certainly people with obviously more and more mobile access, internet access, who are in that target market are expecting utility and benefit from the engagement they have with brands and companies.
Yeah. Now, Jim, Coca-Cola is doing some interesting things with new partnerships, new challenges to get, or new channels to get your products to market. Do you want to talk a little bit about that? I'm thinking about Alexa and some of the other programs.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that's really interesting, part of your opening comments, Jan, is that in North America, 23-ish percent of people buy their groceries online now, which is a huge change. 40% of companies go direct to consumer today with their brands, which is another huge change. So what we've tried to do is think about, because when you have this digital question, it's often confusing in your business, like what, how do you address that and how do you address consumers? And what we decide to do is to actually go to the marketplace and take the marketplace tension to drive our actions. And what I mean by that is we've actually established a new group called a digital integration group that starts with digital commerce as the forefront of how we market to consumers. Mm-hmm. So this group is responsible for pure play. It's responsible for click and collect pickup. It's responsible for restaurant intermediaries, which has a huge impact on our business now because people don't go into restaurants as much. And then the last piece would really be our own e-commerce sites to our own consumers. So we've had to pivot to that market to better understand that, which is unique for us, given the fact we have a franchise distribution system mm-hmm. through bottlers. We have a food service business, and it's become quite useful. And we've also used that group being front-facing to the marketplace to then be responsible for interaction with our digital marketing, with our IT platforms, and also with our data and analytics. So mm-hmm. that's a unique channel of business that we've gone through because consumers now buy differently.
Mm-hmm. Well, and it's interesting because the whole history of the company hasn't been about being within an arm's reach of thirst, and that has a whole different connotation with AI robotics and what's happening with e-commerce.
You know, it's interesting you said that because we used, as your point, we said we wanted to be within an arm's reach of desire, and we've amended that to say we want to be when the clicks reach a desire. So yeah. That's the metamorphosis of that.
Okay. So Italy, great experience, but also an amazing e-commerce platform as well. So how are you connecting the kind of the experience in these amazing marketplaces to the additional business that's coming through the e-commerce platform?
So we obviously launch our e-commerce platform because you must do. Mm-hmm. Nowadays, and we call it Italy Today. In Italy now we deliver within a few hours, and we're expanding on a daily basis. But what we are more interested actually than that is understanding how we can deliver the true experience that you will do in a store right through the platform. This is really what we are focusing today. There is no reason why I shouldn't be able to live chat with my fishmonger to understand what are the daily catch. Because if we talk about fish sustainability, we're talking about something that is coming from very close and probably was fish yesterday or 2 days ago. Mm-hmm. So if I'm online shopping and I'm not truly aware of what's happening, how can I be truly sustainable even if I trust your brand? So at the end of the day, in our mind, we always consider ourselves a storytelling company before than a retail company. Mm-hmm. And I believe information and platform and connectivity for us, the true power is being able to spread this information every day, everywhere, constantly. So this is where we see the future for us. It's to truly inform people on their shopping constantly and live.
Okay. And Frank, with one of the challenges with consumer focus on the planet, smart homes, very complicated to work with the technology and how to get everything connected. Is that an area of focus for NG as you're trying to think about how you deliver services down to these authorities and to institutions and ultimately personal consumers? How do you make it easy?
Well, you just hit it on the nail. The technology is changing so fast that the opportunities are growing all the time and they're changing the options. So our main focus is trying to understand what our customer needs are and to provide them the global solution. But then we need to help them convey that message to their own customers. In a university, you need to be able to tell the candidates or even the students what you have done to improve that university, how you have improved their carbon footprint, and also educate them on how to use the new technologies, how to make their choices, how to manage their heating system or their cooling system. So we have a huge task in educating our customers and our customers' customers in better using, optimizing their carbon footprint.
Mm-hmm. Well, we've touched quite a bit on kind of technology and innovation. Are there any other examples you can give us that are more experiential? Like, I love the whole idea of being able to live chat with a fishmonger, figure out what's fresh today, what's exciting him or her. What other examples would you have of how technology is enabling you to deliver really amazing experiences? Jim or Wendy, go ahead.
You know, I reflect on, I love what Nicola just said on, he considers himself a storytelling business. And that's a very, very powerful statement because, you know, I think we have to remember, you know, no, advertising and branding and marketing, all the things we're trying to do to position brands and companies is an uninvited guest in people's lives. None of us woke up this morning and said, ooh, I hope I see some good advertising today, right? So we have to start from the basis of that the average consumer is seeing 6,000 brand impressions every day. It's just washing over us, just washing over us. So the experience and the deep understanding of that consumer and getting invited into their lives, creating some sort of meaningful value and emotion that then invites that brand into our lives is so important. I reflect on some of the more successful campaigns that our company has done, and none of them now really are TV-based. I have to be careful saying that. I'm not here to profess the death of TV. TV is a very important medium and still has incredible reach for all of our clients. But it is indeed the experiences that are really registering with consumers. So I'll reflect on one specifically, Skittles. We work with Mars. And Skittles this year on the Super Bowl, as they did last year, did not buy a $5 million spot on the Super Bowl. Instead, they created an experience. They put on, we together, put on a full Broadway show with Michael C. Hall, a famous actor from Dexter, and really wrote out a full script and had 1,600 people in a theater on Broadway to experience Skittles the musical. And by the way, the musical was written about how terrible advertising is. Mm-hmm. The main song in it is "Advertising Ruins Everything," sung and danced to on stage. That execution and all of the storytelling leading up to it, so all the earned media and PR that Skittles was doing, a musical, and then the actors and the dancing, and then we released a Spotify playlist of all the songs, all the things we did to create that experience yielded a sales increase during the period for Skittles, and it was largely named in media as the most successful Super Bowl ad that was not on the Super Bowl. That's what we're talking about now. That's an experience. That's something that consumers want to spend time on. There's storytelling, there's value, there's interest, there's intrigue. It sounds outrageous until you go and see that it was actually a fully rehearsed Broadway musical brought to you by Skittles. So I think that's a great example of the types of things that we're doing to engage consumers.
Yeah. Jim?
Yeah, I'll share one. You know, as it's interesting as humans how sometimes we start at one area and then we overdo it on things. And I think at times social media has that. And, you know, consumers now have a love-hate relationship, I think, with social media. And so one of the things that we try to do, and Wendy hit on this about authenticity, you know, your brand has to be authentic to itself. And brand Coca-Cola has always been about that. Authenticity, family with friends, good times, simple moment of pleasure and refreshment. And so there actually is a World Kindness Day. It's on November 13th. And so you can look it up. So last November the 13th, we said, you know, people have gotten so fed up in cases with social media. We're going to take the social media that we have on brand Coke and we're going to get rid of it, wash out all of it. And we're going to send nothing but 100 positive messages to people on World Kindness Day. And we got phenomenal response to that because it really show consumers that you get me. You're in touch with what I'm dealing with, and brand Coke, given what consumers give us permission to do, is authentic to doing that. So it was really successful for us.
Okay. Well, continuing on the theme of authenticity, how important are social media influencers, the Instagram accounts promoting kind of whatever? How is that playing out? How much of a thing is that in influencing behavior?
Unfortunately, I want to say a lot.
Okay.
The problem that I have with influencer is that because many are self-proclaimed and you just see a very small percentage of what they do and who they are, it's hard to understand the knowledge that they have to a specific topic that they are covering. So sometimes you might find yourself forced to work with people that don't actually know the topic that they are discussing, especially in food, which is the one that they care a lot. But on the other hand, you get to know people that are extremely prepared, and without that tools, there would be no one. Mm-hmm. Because they will have no voice, they couldn't get to whatever school or to whatever journal. So we do that a lot. What I think is incredibly important is to screen as much as you can the people that you want to collaborate. And I think we have been teach, I'm not a social media expert whatsoever, but we have been teach that the amount of interaction is much more important than the amount of input that you get. So that the mm-hmm. likes matter to a certain degree, the comments can get much more farther in the future. So what we try to do on that thing is to try to really have an open discussion of whatever topic that we're having. But influencers are important, but you need to study them before collaborating, of course.
Mm-hmm. I might build on that.
Sure.
So there's a stat, and I was trying to remember it perfectly. It's over 60%, I think 62, 63% of millennials and Gen Z don't hope they'll be successful. They think they'll be famous. Like, they don't hope to be famous. They, in their minds, they believe they'll be famous. Why? Because influencers that they have grown up with, again, all their lives, the Kim Kardashians of the world, with no particular skill, not doesn't play an instrument, doesn't act, doesn't, you know, can't sing or dance or, you know, any athletic skill, no particular skill, with some good lighting, some makeup, and cameras, has become a phenomenon. And that tells millennials and Gen Z that they too can be famous without any particular skill. And so you're seeing a little bit of this sort of cycle go through with these consumers heavily influenced by these people who, again, don't have credentials about food or, you know anything in particular, but have a following and have hair and makeup and lights. And that has become part of what definitely influences. Interesting now for some of the brands and companies we work with Johnson & Johnson, the very influencers that they have used for a number of years to promote their products are now going into creating products themselves. So very interesting now that some of the influencers are actually becoming competitors to the brands that they once helped promote, because the influencers have a following enough where they're starting their own lines of business. So it's a very interesting phenomenon happening now.
No, and I'm going to, sorry, go ahead, Frank.
No, I think to your point, you know, you have to screen them, but it's a wonderful way of conveying a message to very different targets. And that's true in a single market, but in our case, where solutions and energy issues are very different geographically, it's very important that geographically we find the right conveyor of the message. And influencers are perfect because they adapt to their markets everywhere and in every market.
Mm-hmm. That's great. Well, and let's continue with the theme of the focus and the concern about climate change. How is that playing out for brands and businesses and products? Let's talk about Italy.
Well, for us, it's amazing that finally we talk about it, right? Because our own philosophy started with the, we embrace an idea of a man called Carlin Petrini. He was the Slow Food Movement founder. And he said, food should be good, clean, and fair. Mm-hmm. And I think this guy is so clever that he also put it in the right order. We all started with good, which means it needs to be tasty and it needs to be healthy. And basically today, everyone is marketing that. Mm-hmm. Now we're entering in the clean phase. People are start asking, how do you make these products? Is this sustainable for the environment? Is this good enough for me to buy? And I think very soon, I don't know how soon, but I think very soon, we're gonna start talking about fair. How much do you pay your employees? How much did you pay these products? How much the farmer is making for that? Mm-hmm. And we're ready, because we've been doing that since the beginning. So for us, it's just a matter of how much we can say of these three messages, because the consumer is ready and wants to talk about it, than anything else. One of the last things that we did, we launched this zero waste impact. Mm-hmm. And we're trying to tackle everything that is connected to what we do, from packaging in the store, but also the way you're gonna transform the food in your house. And of course, it's a very long battle that is gonna change all the time, mm-hmm. because new technology are gonna rise, new products are gonna come. But it's just one step every day. The consumers like it, we like it, and I think it's just a better way to go.
Yeah. Well, and I used to live in Hong Kong, and it was 8 years ago, and I was still living there. One of the major restaurants had on their menu low carbon choice, and I thought, okay, that's a typo. They meant low carb, but they meant low carbon because it was locally sourced, so it wasn't as much carbon impact in terms of how they got food to the restaurant. So again, another example of how that plays out. Other thoughts on how this is influencing
behavior?
Yeah,
I mean, I think you're seeing, especially for big companies, now the proclamation, and Jim and I used to work together, so we have to full disclosure, every now and then slip into talking about Coke, but using their scale for good. Coke is water neutral in its development of products. It puts back the same amount of water that it uses in all of its beverages and the making of its beverages back into the water. It has that commitment. McDonald's in the Nordics is now the largest electric car charging network in the country, in the Nordics, across the Nordics, across that region, using their restaurants to have electric car charging stations. That doesn't necessarily have anything to do with selling their food, but of course, when you think about it, it puts good back into the world, uses their scale and their geography across those countries to allow people to charge their cars, and gosh, while you're in the parking lot, maybe you'll come inside and buy something. Using your scale for good is what we hear over and over again with these companies, and they're publicly holding themselves accountable, putting out those targets, working towards those targets, and all the way back to the beginning of the conversation, that's really motivating, powerful, and impacting to consumers.
Mm-hmm. Jen, can I add one
sure,
thing?
Sure, please do.
To Wendy's point, I mean, I think it's table stakes now. If you have to be authentic, first of all, it has to be part of your DNA, but if not, you have to get there quickly because it's just so important to consumers. And the one thing that I would just add to that, as Wendy said, around water replenishment and carbon footprint and those types of things, you know, one of the things that we're trying to tackle is plastic waste, mm-hmm. because it is becoming a big challenge in the world, and especially here in North America. And so one of the things that we've done is established a declaration called A World Without Waste, which is by 2030, we want to recover and reuse one bottle or can for everyone we sell worldwide, which is a big, bold commitment, but it's one that we're committed to live up to. And so what we've tried to do initially is to do things like educate consumers on recycling. There's a lot of confusion out there about what do I recycle and where does it go. We've also tried to help those that are in that business in municipalities. So for example, in America, only 30% of municipalities have a recycling program, a recovery program, which a lot of people don't know about. It's a big opportunity, so we're trying to help there. We're also trying to look at our own packaging. So in some cases, we're taking, in all cases, we're looking at our packaging to make sure that we can take out things that we don't need, use recycled material. And then the last thing I would say is looking at our own manufacturing dispensing opportunities. So for example, we have now a technology where you can have packageless water dispensing. So you can have flavored water or sparkling water or something that consumers won't have to use a package to carry around with water. So we're really, really focused on that. But that's another example of some things we're working on.
Okay. Frank, anything from this?
No, I think that description says it all. Companies should be looking at their full footprint. And it's a very vast subject. It goes effectively from waste to water consumption, to energy consumption, and also it needs to be solved locally. So you need to have the different solutions would be in Hong Kong, in Toronto, Brazil, Paris. The resources are different and the solutions are different. It's amazing how people can now leverage technologies that were not available only a few years ago to make progress, and this is gonna be on for forever. I have one example in lighting. So the development of LED lighting is extremely beneficial to energy consumption. It's far from being used, but if you go into public lighting, you can actually use the same devices to control traffic, make public traffic more efficient, go faster, to inform people. So these technologies are now used. If they're used globally, they're even more efficient.
Okay. I want to tackle, we've got time for two more topics. I want to tackle something controversial, and then we'll go with something that'll be a little bit easier to wind things up. Data. A lot of debate going on about data. You hit the nail on the head. I'm like that consumer you spoke about, Wendy. I get annoyed if I get stupid stuff coming at me from social media. Yet you've got the other side of the debate that says how much data should be permitted. Where do you see this? I don't want your personal opinion, but I'm looking for where do you see this argument landing? How does this get resolved about the need for better data to give better consumer impact versus the concern about why do you have so much of my data?
Oh, good, me.
Thank you, Wendy.
Here's, I think, the discussion on data. You've seen the handover. Consumers, and I think we, again, take our professional hats off for a second and act like a consumer. I am willing to transact with you and give you my data if you make good use of it. If you use it in a way that benefits my life, that gives me some sort of utility benefit, then it's good for me. You know, if Italy knows that on Thursdays I like this and I typically come in, for them to proactively say to me, oh, today, you know, that this is your habit, and I'm gonna proactively offer you something that's right in line with your habits, that feels great. That feels like it's saving me time. It's the one thing you said, we're time-starved. So if you use my data well, great. It's when you use my data incorrectly that I get really frustrated. And so I don't think consumers, you know, hat out of hand, are against use of data. I don't think that that's the case. I think they're against the propagation and the reckless use of my data. And so I think, you know, that's sort of one thought at the beginning. The second thought I would offer is the platforms are big enough. The Googles, the Facebooks, you know, YouTubes, Twitters, everyone else in the world are big enough and have the technological prowess to help solve this. Let's not forget, they have built these incredible platforms and engines. They continue to do incredible technical feats, advancements with their technology. They can solve brand safety and safe use of data. So I think we have to drive some accountability with the firms that are largely using the data, and they can set the tone for the rest, and that will flow down. So I think, you know, brand safety is going to be important. Safe use of data is important. And I think this is infinitely solvable, but I don't think it's going to be a place where consumers don't want their data used. I think they want it used responsibly and well.
Okay. Other thoughts? Frank?
There's an additional, I totally agree with this, but there is an additional thing that gives me a lot of optimism in the future is switchability. It's extremely easy when you're annoyed to just switch off. And if your data is being used in a way that you don't like, you can not use it, switch off, and get away and find something else. And the amount of service that is available, contrary to in the past, service were available locally. You only had one supermarket and you only had one newspaper. Now you can go to whatever you want, access to all the data, and when it's not properly used, when it doesn't serve a purpose, you just move on to the next one. So there is a natural selection of people, I hope that in the past, within the future, will have only better use of data.
Any thoughts, Nicola? I'm just thinking about your time, which is, you know, I fully agree with that. I'm always focused on what can I do to save time? How can this make this faster, easier? Anything in the context of what you're doing, both through your e-commerce platform, that is helping to address the time issue as well?
Well, I think in principle, we all agree, right? It needs to be willing. You need to want to share your data. If you're sharing with one company, you're sharing only with one company and with the one branch of that company, of that specific service you're getting. I think, though, this is very difficult because we all agree on what we want to do and we keep doing the opposite, right? And I think it's going to be an higher topic. I think probably most of the government of the world are going to need a minister of algorithm. Because every time I hear the word algorithm, it's like telling me that I don't know what it is, so I'm never going to understand it. Let's move on to the next topic. I think there are millions of things in the world that we don't understand, like pharmaceutical, but they are regulated. And I don't get to buy a meds in a pharmacy if it wasn't approved by a certain amount of people who know what they're doing. So my expectation is that eventually we're all going to agree that we need an higher third-party instrument to truly understand how this data moves through the world. Okay. And how we're going to get there. But one of the things that give me a little hope, I'm seeing now new companies starting paying you for your data. So I think people are starting understanding that that data has a value for real, in money, in real money, not only as we said it. And I think, as usual, maybe the market is going to start regulating itself. And people are going to pay for it, and then somebody's going to start saying to Facebook, maybe I want some money of what you're sharing about my information. And I think this is probably going to put some more limitations sooner than anything higher that we can do all together.
Yeah, no, I agree, and I appreciate the feedback. It's something we're trying to tackle with right now in terms of our interaction with the business community and with innovation as it's moving forward. But the one thing I think somewhat related, not so much to pure play data, but more this whole consumer experience with everything being so immediately and technologically driven, in the business you're in with NG, this is putting a lot of pressure on our governments, municipalities, institutions to deliver services on a far different footing than what they've been able to do in the past. And they simply haven't had the financial wherewithal to connect technology and create these opportunities. So any reflection on that, Frank, around the pressure that this e-commerce experience is creating for other service providers in less traditional field, or more traditional areas?
Again, to what I was saying before, if you want to, it's not enough to be virtuous. You need to be able to tell people and educate people how to do that. And going to cities and universities, helping them in their zero carbon transition is only half the way. You need to also help them communicating that to their people. And we create apps for cities to be able to tell their citizens when to go to the swimming pool because the water is being properly treated or because there is less people in there. We need to tell parents how their schools are improving their carbon footprint. And in this particular case, we had a contract with 140 cities in Paris. The program included training the teachers on how to use the new technology and also how to educate their own pupils. So, and you cannot do that without the use of internet and the use of applications where you give that access to the end consumer.
That's great. Okay, we're gonna wind this up. I wanna do a quick round with each of you. What's next? What's the next big consumer trend that we need to be thinking about, that we need to be aware about, that you're all thinking about in your businesses that we haven't already discussed? Jim, let's start with you.
I think in my business, it's uber personalized beverages for people. And down the road, it could be as much as I wake up in the morning and my personal device tells me what I need, when I need it, how I need it. And I think, I'm not sure when that's gonna happen, but I think that's on the horizon. That's gonna be consistent with the things we talked about.
Okay. Italy?
Well, I think I said it earlier. To me, is this fair situation is going to get to 100.1% transparency on everything you do in your own business. And I think the earlier you do, the most successful you're going to be as a company, because I think very soon it's going to be a demand from the customers. It's not going to be voluntary anymore. Mm-hmm. People are just going to ask what you do with your money, where do you go, where do you buy things. So the sooner big companies reach 100% transparency, I guess the sooner they are gonna get to be back a small company, close to the people, and really have an interaction.
Frank?
I think, I don't know if it's a change, but I think it's an acceleration of the level of people understanding, education. The fact that you can access to answers to your questions anytime, you know, going to Google, asking questions at any time of the day is increasing the level of education, understanding, awareness of people to a level that was never reached before, and that's gonna continue. What is the product, what are the consequences, what are the quality of the product I'm looking at the service I'm looking at, what other people think about that. So the transparency and the access to data is elevating the level of understanding and education people to an amazing level.
Wendy?
Yeah, I think got really great answers. So every time someone answered, I was like, well, I can say that. you know, I think we're going to see the impact globally of the continued penetration of technology that is going to reshape how we look at the world. Our lens tends to be from a very developed market view, but as you know, 2/3 of the world's population carry mobile phones now. Over 50% have internet access. Those numbers are going to continue to climb over the next 10, 20 years. And as you see the furthest reaches of the least targeted populations now have the benefit of worldwide access because they are on the internet and technological impact to their businesses, to their lives, to their societies. The rise of the unreached today is going to surely create this wave and impact for all companies and brands to address, which is going to be amazing. The societal impact will be incredible. Obviously, then you see the middle class continuing, people propagating further and further into the middle class and having the consumption benefit, as we're talking about consumption. That's not that far out now. You know, that's 10, 20 years away in a way that's going to have incredible impact to the world. So I think to answer the question more succinctly, you're going to see the continued impact of technology and global access through the internet. I think it's going to happen in the near term, and we're going, in our lifetimes, we're going to see how that plays out globally for the 7-8 billion people in the world. It's going to be amazing.
Yeah, and I think one of the key takeaways, and I think, Jim, just pulling on your point, I think it's going to be this incredible ability of smart data points to enable pushing the consumer. And you think about it, you know, for seniors, it's time to eat, it's time to do this. It's quite incredible how that's going to be kind of this push-pull approach to consumption. Thank you very much. Please join me in thanking a great group of panelists. Thank you.